In this module, we shall discuss about total factor productivity and economic growth. Colonial Americans were very poor by today's standard of poverty. On the eve of American Revolution, GDP per capita in the United States stood at approximately $765 in 1992. Incomes rose dramatically over the next two centuries, propelled upward by the Industrial Revolution, and by 1997, GDP per capita had grown to $26,847. This growth was not always smooth, but it has been persistent at an average annual growth rate of 1.7%. Moreover, the transformation brought by the Industrial Revolution moved Americans off the farms to jobs in the manufacturing and increasingly the service sector of the economy. Understanding this great transformation is one of the basic goals of economic research. Theorists have responded with a variety of models. Marxian and neoclassical theories of growth assign the greatest weight to productivity improvements driven by advances in technology and the organization of production. On the other hand, the new growth theory and another branch of neoclassical economics, the theory of capital and investment, attach primary significance to the increase in investments in human capital, knowledge, and fixed capital. The dichotomy between technology and capital formation carries over to empirical growth analysis. Generally speaking, the empirical growth economists had two main tasks. First, to undertake the enormous job of constructing historical data on inputs and outputs. And second, to measure the degree to which output growth is, in fact, due to the technological factors, that is, productivity versus capital formation. This last undertaking is sometimes called sources of growth analysis and is the intellectual framework of the TFP residuals, which is the organizing concept of this survey. After studying this module, you shall be able to know the concept of total factor productivity, to understand the correlation between TFP and the energy conversion efficiency, learn about the importance of residual in the concept of total factor productivity. Let us first discuss total factor productivity in detail. Total factor productivity is the portion of output not explained by the amount of inputs used in production. As such, its level is determined by how efficiently and intensively the inputs are utilized in production. In economics, total factor productivity, TFP also called multi-factor productivity, is a variable which accounts for effects in total output not caused by traditionally measured inputs of labor and capital. If all inputs are accounted for, then total factor productivity can be taken as a measure of an economy's long-term technological change or technological dynamism. TFP cannot be measured directly. Instead, it is a residual, often called the solo residual, which accounts for effects in total output not caused by inputs. The equation in Cobb-Douglas form represents total output as function of total factor productivity, A, capital input, K, labor input, L, and two inputs respective shares of output, alpha and beta, are the capital input share of contribution for K and L respectively. An increase in either A, K or L will lead to an increase in output. While capital and labor inputs are tangible, total factor productivity appears to be more intangible, as it can range from technology to knowledge of workers, that is human capital. Y is equal to A, K raised to the power alpha and L raised to the power beta. Technology, growth, and efficiency are regarded as two of the biggest subsections of total factor productivity. The former possessing special inherent features such as positive externalities and non-trivialness, which enhance its position as a driver of economic growth. Total factor productivity is often seen as the real driver of growth within the economy, and studies reveal that while labor and investment are important contributors, total factor productivity may account for up to 60% of growth within economies. TFP is more accurately measured in long term. Since TFP can vary substantially from one year to another, it has been shown that there is a historical correlation between TFP and energy conversion efficiency. TFP growth is usually measured by solo residual. Let us GY denotes the growth rate of aggregate output, GK the growth rate of aggregate capital, GL the growth rate of aggregate labor, and alpha the capital share. The solo residual is then defined as GY minus alpha GK minus 1 minus alpha into GL. The solo residual accurately measures TFP growth if, number 1, the production function is neoclassical, number 2, there is perfect competition in factor markets, and number 3, the growth rates of the inputs are measured accurately. TFP plays a critical role on economic fluctuations, economic growth, and cross-country per capita income differences. At business cycle frequencies, TFP is strongly correlated with output and hours worked. The TFP model produces an explanation of economic growth based solely on production function and the marginal productivity condition. Thus, it is not a theory of economic growth because it does not explain how variables on the right-hand side of the production function, labor, capital, and technology evolve over time. However, Solow himself provided an account of this evolution in a separate and slightly earlier paper. He assumed that labor and technology were exogenous factors determined outside the model, and that investment is a constant fraction of output. Then, if technical change is entirely labor augmenting and the production function is well behaved, the economy converges to a steady state growth path along which both output per worker and capital per worker grows at the rate of technical change. Coase in 1965 and Koopman in 1965 arrive at essentially the same conclusion using different assumptions about the saving investment process. Both of these neoclassical growth models produces a very different conclusion from that of the TFP model about the importance of technical change in economic growth. In the neoclassical growth models, capital formation explains none of the long-run steady-state growth in output because capital is itself endogenous and driven by technical change. Technical innovation causes output to increase, which increases investment, which thereby induces an expansion in the stock of capital. This induced capital accumulation is the direct result of TFP growth and in steady-state growth. All capital accumulation and output growth are due to TFP. While real-world economics rarely meet the conditions for steady state growth, the induced accumulation effect is present outside steady state conditions. Whenever the output affects the TFP, growth generates a stream of new investments. Moving on to the measurement of TFP. The residual is a valid measure of the shift in the production function under the solo assumptions. However, because the TFP residual model treats all capital formation as a wholly exogenous explanatory factor, it tends to overstate the role of capital and understate the role of innovation in the growth process. Since some part of the observed rate of capital accumulation is a TFP-induced effect, it should be counted along with TFP in any assessment of the impact of innovation on economic growth. Only the fraction of capital accumulation arising from the underlying propensity to invest at a constant rate of TFP growth should be scored as capital independent contribution to output growth. The distinction between the size of the residual on the one hand and its impact on growth on the other has been generally ignored in the productivity literature. This oversight has come back to haunt the debate over assimilation versus accumulation as the driving force in economic development. A number of comparative growth studies have found that the great success of the East Asian tigers was driven mainly by the increase in capital and labor rather than by TFP growth. With diminishing margin returns to capital, the dominant role of the capital implies that the East Asian miracle is not sustainable and must ultimately wind down. However, these conclusions do not take into account the induced capital accumulation effect. The role played by the TFP growth is actually larger and the saving investment effect is proportionately smaller. Neoclassical growth models assume that innovation is an exogenous process, with the implication that investment in R&D have no systematic and predictable effect on output growth. But can it really be true that the huge amount of R&D investment made in recent years was undertaken without any expectation of gain? A more plausible approach is to be abandoned the assumption that the innovation is exogenous to the economic system and to recognize that some part of innovation is, in fact, a form of capital accumulation. This is precisely the view incorporated in endogenous growth theory of Romer and Lucas. The concept of capital is expanded to include knowledge and human capital and is added to conventional fixed capital, thus arriving at total capital. Increments of knowledge are put on an equal footing with all other forms of investment, and therefore the rate of innovation is endogenous to the model. The key point of endogenous growth theory is not, however, that R&D and human capital are important determinants of output growth. What is new in endogenous growth theory is the assumption that the marginal product of capital is constant, not diminishing as in the neoclassical theories. It is the diminishing marginal return to capital that bring about convergence to steady state growth in the neoclassical theory, and conversely, it is constant marginal returns that cause the induced accumulation effect on capital to on ad infinitum. Most of the TFP studies that have incorporated product-oriented innovation into the residual have focused on capital-embodied technical change. Nelson, in 1964, expressed the residual as a function of the rate of embodiment and the average age of the capital stock. Domer, in 1963, and Jorgensen, in 1966, observed that capital is both an input and an output of the production processes, and the failure to measure capital inefficiency units causes two types of measurement error, one associated with the mismeasurement of capital input and one with the mismeasurement of investment good output. Surprisingly, the two errors exactly cancel in golden rule steady state growth, leaving the residual unbiased. Once it is recognized that product quality adjustment allow consumer welfare parameters to creep into the TFP residual, the boundary between the supply side conception of the residual and the demand side interpretation is blurred. If welfare considerations are permitted inside one region of the supply side boundary, and they must be, if the quality dimensions of output is to make sense, perhaps they should be permitted in other boundary area, such as the net versus gross output controversy, where welfare argument have also been made. After all, a high rate of real GDP growth and hence a large gross output productivity residual can be sustained in the short run by the depleting irreproducible resources at the expense of long run welfare. Net output solves this problem by controlling for depreciation and environmental damage. Some believe that it thus provides a more accurate picture of sustainable long run economic growth. Does it not follow that a separate TFP residual based on net output is the appropriate indicator of the contribution of costless technical innovation is sustainable growth? The short answer is no. Changes in social welfare can be shown to depend on the standard gross output concept of TFP, with no need to define a net output variant of TFP. TFP residual can, in principle, be computed for every level of economic activity, from the plant floor to the aggregate economy. These residuals are not independent of each other because, for example, the productivity of a firm reflects the productivity of its component plants. Similarly, industry residuals are related to those of the constituent firms, and productivity in the aggregate economy is determined at industry level. As a result, productivity at aggregate level will increase if productivity in each constituent industry rises, or if the market share of the high productivity industry increases, and so on down the aggregation hierarchy. A complete picture of the industrial dynamics of an economy would include a mutually consistent measure of the TFP residuals at each level in the hierarchy and of the linkage used to connect levels. The task of constructing this hierarchy of residuals can be approached from the top down in a process that can be likened to unpeeling an order to reach lower layer of structure. Domer was the first to work out the problem of unpeeling the TFP residual and to recognize the complication introduced by the presence of intermediate goods. This complication arises because plants and firms in each sub-layer produce goods and services that are used as inputs in the production process of the plant and firms. As each layer is unpeeled, the magnitude of these intermediate deliveries grows. For example, there are no intermediary goods in the aggregate economy because there is only one industry at this level of aggregation and all inter-industry flow cancel out. However, these inter-industry flows uncancel in passing. To the one-digit industry level of detail. The iron ore delivered to the steel industry is counted in the gross output of the extractive industry and is counted again as part of the gross output of the manufacturing industry. The sum of the one-digit industry gross output is therefore larger than total aggregate output. The nature of this problem can be made more precise by observing that the total output of an industry, plant, firm is composed of deliveries to final demand plus deliveries of the industry output to the other industry that use the good. On the input side, the firm use not only labor and capital but also intermediary goods purchased from other industry that use the good. Several studies have attempted to link the micro and macro levels of analysis. Bailey, Alton, and Campbell, 1992, used data from the LRD into the weighted sum of plants level residuals. It was found that the plants with the rising TFP levels and plants with the high pre-existing TFP levels were the main contributors to the productivity growth. Firms with the low pre-existing TFP levels and declining firms were dragging productivity. The persistence of firms with both high and low level of productivity suggests a more complex view of industrial organization than the simple representative agent model used to motivate aggregate TFP residual. The micro data also suggests a more complex productivity dynamic in which the entry and exit of firms as well as their expansion and contraction are important dimensions. Let us now summarize what we have learned in this module. Any respectable biography must end with a summary judgment of the subject at hand, and above all, true character of the subject should be revealed. This is particularly important in the case of TFP residual, the true character of which has often been misunderstood by friends and critics alike. The portrait painted in this paper reveals the essential features. Number one, the TFP residual captures changes in the amount of output that can be produced by a given quantity of inputs. Intuitively, it measures the shift in the production function. Two, many factors may cause this shift. Technical innovation, organizational and institutional changes, shift in societal attitude, fluctuation in demand, and changes in factor shares, omitted variables, and measurement errors. The residual should not be equated with technical change, although it often is. Third, to the extent that productivity is affected by innovation, it is the costless part of technical change that it captures. This manna from heaven may reflect spillover externalities thrown off by research projects, or it may simply reflect inspiration and ingenuity. 4. The residual is non-parametric index number designed to estimate one parameter in the larger structure of production, the efficiency shift parameter. It accomplishes this by using prices to estimate marginal products. 5. The various factors comprising TFP are not measured directly but are lumped together as a leftover factor, hence the name residual. They cannot be sorted out within the pure TFP framework, and this is the source of the famous epithet, a measure of our ignorance. 6. The Divisia index must be path independent to be unique. The discrete time counterpart of the Divisia index, the Tronquist approximation, is an exact number if the underlying production function has the translog form. The problem of path dependence is one of the uniqueness, and this is not the same thing as measurement bias. 7. The condition for path independence are A. The existence of an underlying production function, and B. Marginal productivity pricing. Neither constant returns to scale nor Hickson neutrality are absolutely necessary conditions, although they are using assumed for convenience of measurement. 8. When the various assumptions are met, the residual is a valid measure of the shift in the production function. However, it generally understates the importance of productivity change in stimulating the growth of output, because the shift in the function generally induces further movements along the function as capital increase. 9. The residual is a measure of the shift in the supply side constraint on welfare improvement, but it is not intended as a direct measure of this improvement. To confuse the constant with the objective function. 10. When full equilibrium does not pertain, as in the midst of any lagged adjustment process, the marginal equivalences needed for successful aggregation do not obtain, and it is likely that some of the increases in productivity of labor and capital will be recorded as increases in the quantity of labor and capital inputs. It seems to that whatever TFP does measure, and there is cause for concern as to how to answer that question, is empathetically does not measure all of the technological change. In the long term, we are interested in increases in output per unit of labor resources. While people are of course free to measure anything that seems interesting to them, the degree of confusion surrounding TFP, particularly the assumption that low TFP numbers implies a low degree of technological dynamism, would seem to us to justify dropping the measure completely from all discussions of long-term economic growth. Even if that does not happen, as we are sure it will not, every TFP measure should carry the caveat. There is no reason to believe that changes in TFP in any way measures technological change.